copy of the Bible. Kindly turn with us to Luke chapter 3. And we shall read from verse 16. Verses 16 and 17. This is the time Jesus is being introduced into the public world. A very, very, very important, crucial event in the history of mankind. John the Baptist, he is doing his ministry near Jordan. It was tiring of the people. Pharisees, priests, they were thronging to John the Baptist to get baptized for the remission of their sins. Publicans were coming. Common people were coming. Soldiers were coming. And there was a stir, a movement, and he was very harsh. Even a very big crowd was coming there for baptism, for the remission of their sins, to put an end to the old life and to start a new life. He was calling them children of vipers. For a Jew, it means children of the devil. He was talking to them about giving the fruit of repentance. So one after the other, they were asking a very big question, a question of the mankind: what shall I do to have the remission of my sins? What shall I do to have the remission of my sins? And they all were expecting an anointed king, a Messiah, a Christos, a Christ, an Iravan, to come and deliver the people. But their expectation was delivering the people from the clutches of Rome, from the slavery of Rome. Expectation Their expectation of delivering the people, maybe from that harsh religious system, or the leaders of that religious system. Their deliverance was political, their deliverance was physical, their deliverance was financial, somebody who could elevate them from their miseries. They were unable to see a spiritual deliverance. But John was giving baptism for the remission of sins. Something very important, something new in the history was taking place. So they thought, John this John could be that anointed king. This John could be that Christos, Messiah. So they asked John, "Are you that Christ?" The expected Messiah. "Are you going to give us a kingdom?" He said, "I am not going to give the kingdom. I am just only a forerunner. That Christos, that anointed king, who can give the deliverance is coming. And he was introducing that deliverer to the people. So when I was meditating this passage on the past days, in the book of Luke and also in the book of Matthew, this was the first introduction of the King of Kings to the world, about the Messiah, about that Christ. So verse 16, very crucial. John answered, saying unto them all, I indeed baptize you with water, but one mightier than I cometh, the latchet of whose shoes I am not worthy to unloose. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire, whose fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly purge his floor and will gather the wheat into his garner, but the chaff he will burn with fire unquenchable. So here we see a few revelation about this Messiah to come. Number one, he is greater than John. There is no comparison. In an uncomparable way, this Messiah is greater than John. John is not worthy even to remove the shoelace of this Messiah. So this man is very great. Number two, this man will baptize people with the Holy Ghost. John was baptizing people only with water. This Messiah will baptize people with Holy Ghost. Number three, this Messiah will baptize people with fire. When he said baptize, he will, in their language, the understanding was, he would immerse them in fire. He would immerse them in the Holy Spirit. He would wash them thoroughly, bought them with the fire, with the Holy Spirit. So he will be greater than John. He will wash them or immerse them thoroughly with the Holy Spirit, and he will wash them with fire. Number four, he has got a winnowing basket. What do we call that in Tamil? Nakoda? Thootukodai, thootukodai. He's not a fan. It's not a shovel. Some translation, you may hear the word winnowing shovel. In the latter days, they have seen people using shovels. It was a basket. He will have a winnowing basket, a thootukodai in his hand. Number four, and he will thoroughly purge his floor, threshing floor. He will thoroughly purge his threshing floor, and Number 6, and will gather the wheat into his garner. He will gather the wheat into his garner. Number 7, but the chaff he will burn with fire, unquenchable. So a sevenfold introduction of this Messiah, this Christos, this Irvine, John was giving to the people. He will be greater than John. He will be baptizing people with the Holy Spirit. He'll be baptizing people with fire. He will have a winnowing basket in his hand. He will thoroughly purge his threshing floor. He'll gather the wheat into these garners, and he will burn the chaff in fire, unquenchable. This morning, very briefly, I want to talk to you about this threshing floor, winnowing basket, gathering into the garner, burning the chaff. A very powerful allegory. The whole world may be getting ready to celebrate the advent of Christ. With November 1, the Advent period started. You may wonder how November 1 is very special. October 31, the Halloween night, all the evil spirits will come from their abode. That's October 31. That's where we got the night of the devils. Now it has become a celebration. Most of these celebrations have a connection with all these things. So all the evil spirits from their underworld, they come out. So they believe the saints will also come out. So November 1, they had the All Saints Day. Then somebody asked a question. My tata, my appa, he is neither a devil nor a saint. What happened to his spirit? Why do you worry? October, November 2, you'll have All Souls Day. So November 3rd, October 31 for all the devils. November 1 for the saints, departed saints. November 2 for all souls. It was a practice in the Druids, the witches of the Scotland, to come out on October 31. And they will be singing carols for 2 months to collect their essentials. So in the night they will go around, sing and collect their essentials. With that, this all started. My dear brother, my dear sister, so this is the background. We have a lot of festivals around us. There's a reason November 1st Sunday, the first Advent Sunday, begins. But what's the purpose? Or what's the picture of this Messiah who came into this world? What's the picture of this Messiah who came into this world? He'll baptize us with the Holy Spirit. He'll baptize us with fire. And he is greater than John. Okay, that's all right. The picture of that Jesus. He has got a winnowing basket in his hand. And he was standing in the threshing floor. The chief were brought to the threshing floor. Now they are making the oxen to walk on the sheaf to separate the sheep and the wheat or the chaff. But all are on the threshing floor. The cattle were going round and round and round and round and round and round, stamping on the sheaf. As these cattle were stamping on the sheaf, the wheat or the chaff coming out of the sheaf, falling on the floor. The cattle are going round and round and round. I don't know how many have seen these scenes. It was a very great joy for us. Maybe till I could come to Chennai, probably in every harvest I have seen this. There were a lot of threshing floors nearby our school. How many of you have seen these threshing floors? I see only one hand. If you have never seen a threshing floor, probably you may not understand what I am saying. Now I don't know whether I should say this in Tamil or English or preferably Hindi. So you can understand, I can't understand. You have never seen a threshing floor. You won't be able to understand it. I don't know what I can do to explain this. Okay, the harvest is over. How many of you have at least seen a sheaf of wheat or rice? A sheaf of wheat or rice? Arisi kadir. You have seen? Have you seen at least in the picture? Okay. So they will harvest the sheaf, make it a big bundle, mostly keeping it on their head, or on a cart, they would bring to a very big ground, an open ground. And they will spread all these sheaves on that ground. That is called a threshing floor. That is called a threshing floor. And they will make it a very big circle. Maybe to the height of 1.5 feet. To the height of feet. They will keep this sheaf spread over. And they will bring mostly two oxen. And they muzzle the oxen because the oxen will eat everything. But there is a law. Don't muzzle the oxen that threshes this sheaf. But our people will muzzle that ox. They put a mouth cover. Poor oxen, they will walk on this sheaf. Go round and round and round and round. They take many rounds. When these oxen are going round and round and round, because of the pressure and all, the wheat or the rice or even the chaff will come out, but all three will be lying there. What all three will be lying there? Can you tell me? Then only you can see. If you don't have the picture, you can't understand. What are the three things lying there? The wheat will be lying there, the sheaf will be lying there, and the chaff. All three will be lying there. Only thing, it is separated from the sheaf. So there will be mostly women or a man. In our country, generally they take it in a, what we say, cholavu, moro. Tomorrow, what they say in English? Da? Shiv? Shiv is not, that's Saladai. No, not the Saladai. Shiv is Saladai. Moram? You all know Moram? Huh? There's no English word. We'll coin one. Okay. But generally when we say sieve, it's in English, it's chaladai. Sifter, that's right. What is chaladai now? This is sifter. Now I know. This is sifter. Sieve is for the straining, chaladai. Where we strain and take. Here we don't strain. It's only a something to sift. So it was in Palestine, it was a type of a basket. A basket with a small height. The height of a sides of the moram. To the height of the sides of the moram. So they will take in that and they will take and wait for a wind to come. When the wind comes, they'll just pour it on the nearby ground. They'll just pour it. When they pour it, the wind will take away the chaff. Only the grain will fall. Physically, they'll take the sheaf and throw it away. So it will come like a heap. But the wind speed might have changed. The wind might have stopped before they could finish pouring that or emptying that basket. So what they do, they again take it from this heap. Now it's only wheat and chaff. Some chaff were blown off. And they wait for the wind. They wait for the wind direction and they will just pour it. Empty that basket or empty that moram. In a very slow way that the chaff could be taken away. So Jesus, here John, for me it's a very, very important message. Some of you might not have noticed the depth of it. When we talk about the advent of Jesus, even before Jesus came into the picture, in the world arena, the picture is this. He will have a winnowing basket. That is called a winnowing basket. Thootukudai. He'll have a winnowing basket in his hand. He will winnow this, that emptying that basket is called winnowing. He'll winnow it again and again, till he could make sure that all the chaff is driven away, only the wheat is here. Then what they do, they bundle the wheat. That's what we say, one bag, two bags, three bags, like that. They bundle the wheat and they add to the cart. And they will directly take it to the garners, the storehouses, that they have to use it for the whole year. In those days, it was only one mahasul. It is not with a chemical. Now we talk about three mahasul and all. It is only one sowing and reaping. Only one harvest. So what they harvest, they have to keep it for the whole year. They take it to the garners. Now somebody there will immediately sweep all the chaff. Very quickly they will sweep it. You know why? If they don't sweep it, Again this chaff, another wind may take it to the threshing floor, all nearby. And somewhere close by, they'll immediately burn it. And those poor people, they'll take those ashes. Those ashes are good to brush the, to clean your teeth. There's ashes. It will not be useful for anything else. It will not be useful for anything. They'll burn it immediately. And till that threshing floor is complete, that harvest is complete, this process will continue. This process will continue. When I was meditating on this passage, I was able to see a number of parallels which I want to explain to you. Now, the threshing floor is the church. The threshing floor is the church. Where they gather the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves. Sowing in the morning, sowing in the evening, sowing in the noontime, bringing in the sheaves. We sing the song. So this is the place where they bring in all the sheaves from the field, harvest. The seeds were sown, watered, took care of, harvested, and they are bringing in the sheaves. In the parable, Jesus said very carefully, probably later, Jesus said, the wheat and the chaff growing together. So when they make the harvest, the harvester could not make a difference, this is a wheat, this is a weed. They will take the wheat and the weed together. The wheat and the weed together. We all were growing closely together. So they cannot separate it there. So even the wheat and the weed will come. If they know it is a weed, they will just throw it, remove it. So when that was brought to the threshing floor, in the threshing floor, if they are very careful, they remove some of the weed. And some of the weed will also join. But 100%, the harvesters, those who brought the sheaves, they cannot separate, this is a grain, this is a chaff, this is a grain, this is a chaff, they cannot separate. What's the difference between a grain and a chaff? What's the difference between grain and a chaff? Chaff is like a? No, it's not like a powder. The difference between a chaff and a grain, in grain, there will be wheat or rice inside. A chaff will exactly, superficially, externally, overtly, it will look like a grain, but it was totally empty inside. It is totally empty inside. The difference is only inside. The difference is not outside. We call that chavi in Tamil. Outside it will be the same. It will be the same. Inside, if it is a chaff, it will be empty. So when we take one sheaf, in one sheaf, there are a number of kuti-kuti-kuti branches. In every kuti-kuti branch, there will be wheat and chaff, wheat and chaff, wheat and chaff. It's a very big story how that wheat is formed, how the chaff is formed. I think I'm taking a time on farming. It's all depending upon the latter rain. When the sheaf was coming, If the latter rain is good, everything will be in the form of chaff and everything will be empty. If the latter rain is good, the grain will be formed inside. The grain will be formed inside. If the latter rain is not good, totally that will be only chaff. There will be no grain inside. There will be no grain inside. And some of you have seen the paddy fields. Can anybody tell me what is the difference between a sheaf with a lot of grains and a sheaf without grains? Can anybody? That's right. A sheaf with grains will bend. A sheaf with grains will bend. A sheaf without grains, it will stand straight because there's no weight. It's no weight. So when they were plucking it, when they see a sheaf standing straight, there itself they pluck and just put it on the ground. But where they cannot identify, the sheaf is bending. The sheaf was bending. So there was grain in it. They can't throw it. But in between, there will be some sheaf, some chaff. So they can't do anything at the harvesting time. That is why they are bringing this totally chaff. The harvest failed. They can throw it and come. Poor people. But the problem is there was wheat and there was chaff, so they cannot make a difference. They bring it to the threshing floor. And they make these oxen go round and round and round to separate the grain and the chaff from the sheaf. That's done. Now they gather it in one place. Here only we see somebody standing with a winnowing basket. So with that winnowing basket, he collects both the wheat or the grain and the chaff, and he was pouring. He takes an appropriate time. For me to explain this itself is taking time. For the wind to come, and the wind will carry the chaff away. But they do it again and again, 2 times, 3 times, 5 times, to make sure that all chaff is driven away, only the wheat is heaped there, or the rice is heaped there. They bundle all the rice. I'm giving a first-hand information, I have seen that many times. Not only because I read in a book. Really, we are people in Chennai. Our children are becoming more and more unfortunate. The other day, I was seeing a video clip, I was talking with another gentleman all. What all we enjoyed, what all we have seen, we are unable to give that opportunity to our children. Our schools could not give it. Our syllabus could not give it. Most of the schools don't have playground. If they have playground also, the children don't go for play. When they come to the higher classes, it's an evil. When they come to the higher classes, in the timetable they'll have a PT period. In that PT period, the schools will take only subjects. Horrible, miserable. After the school, tuition. Tuition within 4 walls. They don't we run about. Can you say that your children have ever played hide and seek? Robber and police? Goli? Kuchikambu? Here they call it gilli. Gilli. Muthichadiki? No game. No pambaram. Only one thing, sit before a computer game, a video game, sit in a corner, play against a virtual person. It's an evil. When I play football or when I play hockey, I know that ball belongs to 22 people. When your child plays video game in that your smartphone or iPad or computer, that computer belongs to your child. The child doesn't give that to the brother or sister. The child cannot share that computer with somebody. There will be a fight. Probably you have to buy two or three. You are fortunate if you don't have more than that. Because I can play myself in a virtual world. Getting into a virtual, I don't need an opponent. Even in those days when I have to play chess, I need one more person. So that chessboard belongs to two people. When we play carom, four people needed. And we have a team spirit. We have a team spirit. So we put the team. When we play cards, we put the team. Where team end up today? I and my computer. It's an evil. Probably they know swimming in a pool. They don't know what is jumping into your water, into your well. From that wall, we'll jump into the well. Go 25 feet deep. We take sand from the bottom. Or we throw coins, we search for that coin and we bring that coin out. I love fishing. I made my own fishing rods, and then we go and search for this earthworm, put it in the hook. Oh, what a lovely time we all had. I really pity for the children. Now you don't know what a threshing floor. You don't know, you have never seen a sheaf. You have never seen how that is packed. We know only fast food. So we'll come to this passage. I'm struggling with how to explain. I must have had a video clip to explain. So when they were bringing this to the threshing floor, this process is complete. So now the allegory we see from the world, they make a harvest. And the evangelists are the harvesters here. So they tell the good news and bring people to the threshing floor, the good and the bad, the wheat and the chaff. So there was a great feast the king has organized for his son's wedding. So he sent people, and those who were had an invitation earlier, they were unable to make it up. Then he said, you call anybody on the street. So all jane wale, they called. They were not making a choice, good man or a bad man. So when you are inviting somebody to the church, you don't make a choice whether it's a good person, whether he can come to the church or not. Maybe some bad people, those who are making this a profession, they will make a choice whether he's an educator, whether he's rich, whether he can pay a good tithe, whether he can be an asset to the church or not. But a good evangelist, a true evangelist, doesn't make that difference. When I say evangelist, I'm not talking about crusade speakers. You're sharing this good news with somebody in the train, somebody nearby. So when you want to share this news, come to the church, we'll pray. The Lord will do something. You don't make a choice whether he is a good person or a bad person. You bring everybody to the church. That church is the threshing floor. Outwardly, when they are baptized and brought into the church, they all look alike. They all look alike. Suppose in our church, if we stress on uniform, then probably all will be in white. When I want to be a little more fussy about it and I say that you should buy uniform only in Carmel store. So from one bale I can cut out the sari for every sister and we can give to them. Then the uniform will be better. shirt, pants, same type. And also we can have one tailor recommended, Carmel tailor. Then the stitching will also be the same. We can bring uniform. We can make everybody look alike. But inside, is there a grain or if there's only chaff, we cannot make a difference. We can't do anything about it. Now the oxen, which go round and round, round and round, round and round on the sheaf, they are like, can be compared to the pastors. Week after week, week after week, week after week, we teach you that separate yourself from the untoward generation, separate yourself from the world, separate yourself from the worldliness. We just go on preaching. That is holiness preaching, to separate yourself from the sheaf. We go round and round, round and round, round and round, round and round, and we make the separation. Even when you are separated from the sheaf, from the world, from your tradition, both are lying together. As in that field, wheat and weed are there, in the threshing floor, the grain and the chaff are together. The grain and the chaff are together. In the church, vessel unto honor, vessel unto dishonor, together. They that are holy, they that are unholy, they are together. Good and bad are together. Can we say that everybody is good in a church or everybody is bad in a church? No. They are together. Now comes the duty of Jesus. He is also standing in the church with a winnowing basket in his hands. So he takes a heap of the separated chaff and the wheat together, and he started winnowing it. Winnowing it, pouring it, emptying it in a very slow phase. How does he winnow it? He winnows it against the wind. He winnows it against the wind. The wind is the adversary, privation, temptations, difficulties, disappointments. So he winnows the wheat and tares, not tares, I can say the chaff. Tares is color or wheat. Chaff is this empty grains. Okay? Unless you got a mental picture, you cannot understand. There are tares, there are weeds. This is not tares, this is not weeds. They are the chaff. Look like grain. Look like rice. Outer. Inner empty. So he winnows it against the wind. He winnows it against the wind. He does it thoroughly. Repeatedly. He does it thoroughly, he does it repeatedly, again and again. Again and again he does it. Why is he doing again and again? No chaff should come to the garner. No chaff should come to the garner. That garner is the kingdom of God. That garner is the kingdom of God. And the chaff are the imposing Christians, imposters. Outwardly they are Christians, but they don't have the nature of Christ inside. Christ is not formed within. They look like Christians, but they don't have Christian character inside. So he wants to separate from the real Christians from imposing Christians. He separates real Christians from imposing Christians. This is the purpose with which he came. There are beautiful words we see here. Verse 17. Whose fan is in his hand? So that winnowing basket, fan, against fan, you write it on the margin. Winnowing basket. Thootukudai. Something like maram. So the winnowing basket is in his hand. That is his basket. Whose fan is in his hand? It is his basket. It is not the anybody's borrowed basket. And he'll thoroughly purge his floor. He was not a laborer there. The basket belonged to him. The floor belonged to him. Can you tell me what that floor is compared to in our study this morning? Church. Floor is the church. That is his church. Now we are not talking about any gathering. The floor belonged to him. The basket belonged to him. And will gather the wheat into his garner. That garner. Garner is compared to? Kingdom of God, or here it's more specific, heaven. The church itself generally compared to the kingdom of God. And here it is heaven, the eternal heaven. That's also his. The basket is also, winnowing basket is also his. The floor is also his. And the garner is also his. But the chaff doesn't belong to him. He doesn't say, my chaff, I will burn it in my chamber. The chaff doesn't belong to him. He will, the chaff he will burn with fire unquenchable. That speaks about the hell. The chaff, the other fire will be quenched. When he talks about an unquenchable fire, he talks about hell. The chaff will go to hell. The imposters will go to hell. The Christians without Christ inside, he will send them to hell. And here we see a beautiful thing. But the chaff, he will burn with fire unquenchable. He gives a judgment. If we think they are souls, he sends these souls to the unquenchable fire. That's his judgment. He gives the judgment. This chaff should be burnt. So in any church, we've got good people, bad people. We have got all types of people. Now only he has to do this winnowing. How does he do this winnowing? If you bear with me, now only I'm starting the message. It's not my fault. I am compelled to explain what happens, and I have taken this much of time. He does winnowing thoroughly. That word thoroughly is very important. So he does it 2 times, 3 times, 4 times. He does it thoroughly. So how is he doing this winnowing process? One time, what is that wind is compared to? Adversaries, difficulties, disappointment, problems, small misunderstandings, quarrels, etc., etc., etc. Only that can separate the chaff from the wheat, or that can separate the wheat from the chaff. Probably that's a better English. Only that can separate the wheat from the chaff. So God allows. He waits for that wind to come. He waits for that wind to come. Number one, that winnowing process, number one is the word of God. When our difficulties come, the word of God decides who is a chaff, who is a grain. When that wind blows, whether we can stand on the word of God or we cannot stand on the word of God, that separates. It is not enough that we come into the field. It's not enough we participate in the harvest. Not enough we are brought into the threshing floor. Not enough we are separated from the sheaf. There is a time comes, the word of God tests whether we are fully grown grain or we are chaff. In the fully grown grain also, there are a lot of differences. Some will be very tight, even that shell. You won't have any gap to press, fully tight. I can give a simpler example. That's not equal to this, but a simpler example. You take this a groundnut with that shell, groundnut. When you break that shell for the groundnut, sometimes there will be solid fellows inside, solid. Sometimes there will be some weak fellows, they will be there. Sometimes you won't have anything inside. Am I right? Now you can understand. When you take that wear kettle and when you break that outer coat, you can find three different types of wear kettle. One is solid fellows. Only from those solid fellows we can take the oil. And the next one will be, there will be some fellow inside, very weak. And sometimes when you break it, there will be nothing inside. There will be nothing inside. Sometimes this wear kettle will have two or three compartments. In one compartment there will be a solid fellow. In another compartment there will be a weak fellow. And in the third compartment there will be no ground nut. Now how many have understood at least this? Wear kettle purappa, I thank God. At least towards the end I was able to get an example to show you this. So like that, among the grain, the Bible reads, with the fat wheat, with the fat wheat, that badam parup, almond, there are different types of almond. Some almond are chappa almond. Some almond like blessed as gundu almond. There are almonds, premium quality almonds. They say you press it, oil will come. You press it, oil will come. This chappa almond, you do anything, no oil, nothing will come. That gundu almond, you just fry it. You can see the oil, smell the oil coming. Not fry it, roast it. You can see the oil coming. So like that, even with the grains, there are different types of grain. Paul says, every star has got its own glory. In glory, stars differ. So in the rice, it differs. Fully grown, half grown, a little grown. In our faith there is difference, but we all are rice, wheat. We all will be gathered to the Goddess. But in glory will be different. In the shop they'll have keep different rice. The tomato, they keep different tomatoes. You buy anything, you can see difference. I love this panangalangi very much. I know that Bradell also loves panangalangi very much. In some panangalangi, it will be like the little finger. You can't even break it, you have to chew it and throw it. Some panangalangi, solid fellows, but all the panangalangi only. Similarly, in Christians, those who can be added to the garner, there can be difference in the grade. Okay, that bird is better. There can be difference in the grade. But if it's totally a chaff, he has to be burnt. He has to be burnt. So I'm not talking about the grades now. But how to differentiate? The only one differentiation, when that winnowing process, whether you are falling in or you are falling out. When you take a word of God against your difficulties, are you falling in or falling out? Your husband is very loving, very affectionate. The word of God says, obey your husband. It's not very difficult to keep up the word of God. It's not very difficult to keep up the word of God. When there is adversary, when he is against you, when he does the foolish things, in the difficult situation, the word of God tests us, whether we fall in or fall out. Maybe for loving the wife also. You have got all sufficiency and no psychological problem. You are overeaten. And if somebody sees a banana there, they may not like to take it and eat it. They may not like to take it and eat it. You are very hungry. You see one banana, you are going to die. How do we stand for the word? You are in an island only with your wife. There is no other human being in that island. You and your wife. He cannot commit adultery. Is that very difficult for him to commit adultery? For Joseph in a foreign land, a situation, an adverse situation was coming, lurking behind him. How to stand in that situation? So the word of God is one basket he has got in his hands. He adjusts us against the word of God. When the adverse situations come. I just tell you, so for your meditation, I can just give this passage. Now that decides whether you are in or out. And the second basket, or the second winnowing, to cleanse it thoroughly, is the truth. Is the truth. The word of God is the truth. But not generally it's in the Bible or not. The absolute, whosoever may say it, that is the absolute truth. It will not change. It will not change. When that absolute truth comes, where do you stand? The word of God and the truth. There's a slight difference, but the difference is absolute. It is a truth. It is in the Bible. How do you react to the truth in adverse situation? Where joy or pain? When a wind blows, can that wind carry you away? You got a truth. And you want to stand for the truth. It's in the Bible. It's the truth. You want to stand for the truth. The wearing jewels come from idolatry, it is the truth. Wearing jewels come from the idolatry, it is the truth. Now probably it's very easy. You are in a church, nobody wears jewels in that church. And you also don't wear jewels. It's very easy, very simple. You can stand for the truth. But you come to a situation where everybody wears jewels. You become an odd person there. Or they say you can get the job only if you wear this particular type of ornament. You should not be without this ornament. You must wear this. Then only we can give you this job. Or the marriage comes. Some situation. Now there, with reference to that situation, to that wind, with reference to that wind, how will you stand for the truth? This is right or wrong is a different thing. When you know something is the truth, when the truth has been revealed to you and when you have appreciated the truth, when a difficult situation comes, on which side you will be? Word, truth, all related. It's the same winnowing basket. The third one I call character. Character. Our character is often tested against the wind. Maybe not getting annoyed, not shouting, not back answering. A character. Our character is always seen against the wind. The wind tests our character. That character is our winnowing, his winnowing basket. Are we able to demonstrate Christian nature on the cross? Can we forgive them, those who done against me? Can I show that nature? When Simon was able to take some people back to fishing, can I go after Simon and can I reveal him? Can I just give him fish and water to him to win him back? What's my character? May not be a literal word, but what is expected of me? Revealing my character. I can go on and on. This is sufficient for this morning. One of the most important portfolios of Jesus is to test us whether we are grain or chaff. So he winnows us against the wind, winnows us against the wind. The wind is the difficulties that even sometimes have opportunities, some situations against the word, against the truth, against the character. He finds out whether we fall in or we fall out. Against the wind, how is our character? How do we stand for the truth? How do we keep up His word, His commandment, His statutes, His precepts in our lives? Let come what may, I stand for the word of God. That decides whether we are chaff or wheat. I just say one word and conclude. Don't be happy. Don't be happy that you are brought to the threshing floor. Don't be happy that you are brought to the church. We should get into the garner. We can't be happy that from the sea the fish has come to the net, or even come to the boat, or even come to the shore. But the good fish will go to the basket, and the bad fish will be burnt in fire. So it's not a question whether we are brought to the threshing floor. It's a question whether we'll go to the garner or whether we'll be burnt. For that the test is the word of God, the truth, and the nature. Shall we pray? Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you, we praise you, we worship you, O Lord. Help every one of us find an answer for this question. It's not enough that we are brought to the threshing floor. Not enough that we are in the basket, the winnowing basket. But when we are tested against, when we are tested against the wind, how we keep the word of God, how we stand on the truth, how we reveal our character, our nature, whether we'll be gathered to the garner or we'll be burnt to ashes. Dear Father God, help us see the fascinating truth underlying, O Lord. Lord, my capacity to explain these things is very limited. You continue to speak to your people. Make your people understand, Lord, once again, the totality of the truth. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.